Okay, we can see here in this chart the CO2 emission evolution during the last years. So we can see that in the last 16, 70 years, these emissions were increasing exponentially. So in this scenario, environmental awareness is increasing and different governments have adopted measures to reduce these emissions. So we can see here in the chart different standards that are working in different governments to reduce these emissions. So how we work on this? So car makers, from the point of view of the chassis and the part, structural parts, are working in the weight reduction. It is said that a 100 kilogram reduction reduces fuel consumption about 0.3 liters in 100 kilometers. But also we as equipment suppliers, we have several projects to reduce the energy usage in our equipment. Okay, this is an example of a car structure with different materials. And this is a forecast that it's making a car research, where we can see what is foreseen the evolution of the materials in the next years. Yeah. So we can see that nowadays, mostly the main material that is used in the car structure is the steel, but in the following years, it's foreseen that many other materials, well, high stress steels or aluminium, composites and so on, will be in a more quantity in the car structure. So I will try to show what are the different installations that are in the market to produce this kind of materials in the bodywork and chassis parts. So mild steel, aluminium or magnesium parts, usually they are used for exterior parts, doors, laterals and so on, and they are produced in press lines. We will go into more details after. Advanced steels, advanced stress steels, high stress steels or ultra high stress steels, these kind of parts are usually structural parts or chassis parts, and these kind of parts are produced in transfer presses. We will see after again. Boron martensite or high aluminium high strength materials, usually parts to protect the human safety inside the car. And these kind of materials are produced in hot stamping lines. And carbon fiber reinforced plastics or composites, not yet perhaps so much mass productive, but we are seeing more and more these kind of materials in the car parts, and these are produced in composite cells. Okay, so as I said, we will go in detail into these specific lines. So press lines, this is a photo, how looks like a press line. In this case, usually there are from 4 to 6 presses, depending the customer. Usually there is a head press that is quite big, more than 2,000 tons force, and the line presses are around 1,200 tons, more or less. They are produced big parts, could be maximum part, could be 4.5 by 2.2 meters. And the distance between presses is around 5 meters, yeah? And it's running continuous, synchronized continuous mode. From the point of view of automation, they are specialized robots. With the standard robots, it's not possible to achieve high speeds. And it is needed to make simulations before production starts to be able to produce. Yeah? And more or less, the speed is between 15 and 18 strokes per minute. So we will see a video now. This is an installation that we finished last year, that is in SEAT in Barcelona. Yeah, this is a destacker where we are putting the plates in the front of line. So we see here how is the automation system. This is the centering station. The automation system is putting the blanks into the press and moving the part from one press to the other to produce the final part. So this is the final part that we it's putting on the belts. This is the kinematics of the press. And this is the real press. In this case, it's producing two parts in each stroke, two different parts. Good. So in high-speed lines, it is important also the technology of the press. Okay, it could be conventional press or could be a servo press. A conventional press, the drive of the press is with a flywheel, so the energy is stored in the flywheel, and when the part is going to produce, the energy that is stored in the flywheel, it goes to the part. Okay, so the speed is constant, so the cycle that is making the press is constant always. We can change the speed, the strokes per minute, but the cycle is constant. What happens with the servo technology? Well, we remove the flywheel, we put a servo motor, and the servo motor has the capability to change the cycle during the cycle, so we can make different cycles during one each stroke. So we can optimize the drawing process, we can optimize the automation time, so it's much more flexible. It is more expensive, but it is much more flexible. I spoke before about the optimization of the process. In this kind of lines, it is a must to make the simulation before going to the production, because in production it's not possible to adjust the servo press with the automation. Yeah? So we say that first we have to define the cycle of the press and of the automation and the maximum speed that can achieve. Then optimize the press opening and closing, the automation peak and drop position, and then in the end to make the simulation and to make the optimization to achieve the maximum speed. Yeah. We usually say that with 8 hour dedication we can achieve the 80% of the maximum speed, and with 1 week it's possible to achieve the maximum speed that we can go with the installation. So the simulation has two parts. One is the definition of the trajectory and kinematics, and the other one is the simulation itself, that usually the most common softwares are Delmia and Siemens PLS for this specific process. Okay, other important issue in this kind of presses installations is the cushion. The cushion is the device that is used to make the deep drawing process, to hold the blank in the contour and to avoid wrinkles during the drawing process. What you can see here is the hydraulic conventional cushion. So these are the cylinders, and this is the hydraulic unit. You can see that it's quite a complex unit with servo valves, a big tank and so on, maybe high maintenance. So the last development is the what we call e-cushion. It's an electromechanic cushion. It's much more simple. You can see it's a rack and pinion system with a servo motor that is controlling the position and the force of the cushion. And it's integrated into the bed of the press. One big advantage is the energy efficiency. This drawing here is a drawing of a servo press with a conventional hydraulic cushion. So we give power to the main drive, and the slide is pushing the cushion to make the force, the holding force of the sheet metal. And in this case, the energy that we are using in the cushion is going to heat the oil. Yeah, there are losses. Yeah? All the energy goes is losing. Yeah. So with the electromechanic cushion, the energy that we are using for the cushion is recovered and is sent to the net to reuse again in the main drive. And this makes to reduce 80% the energy that you are using in the press, in the full press. Okay, some references. some Fagor Arrasate references, Volkswagen, Foton, China, Gestamp, Slovakia, Great Wall, China, SEAT is the video that we saw, and Gestamp. Yeah. Good. So for high stress steels, transfer presses. This is how it looks like, a transfer press, a big transfer press. Usually it is only one transfer press, but it is possible also to have two of them synchronized. Usually tonnages are from 800 to 5,000 tons. Medium parts, 2.2 by 1 meter. Several stations per press, we will see after in the video. And it is also running in continuous mode. In this case, the automation system is a transfer system. And the simulation is needed to achieve the maximum possible speed, but it's not a must. Yeah? We can work with no simulation. And production, it's a bigger variation, but could be from 10 to 40 SPM, depending the complexity of the part and the installation. So another a homemade video of a transfer installation. So we can see here that there are several stations in the press, and the transfer system, the transfer rails, are moving the part from one station to the other. Different kind of parts. In this case also, the simulation is used to optimize the production. The procedure is very similar. In this case, the kinematic trajectory we make also with a synchro software, and also the simulation is made by Delmia or PLS. And we say that in 8 hours, it's possible to optimize the speed of the installation. Good, about the servo press or conventional press, what we said in the press line, it is the same in this case. But in this case, also, we've got an extra advantage of using the servo technology, that is the spring back effect. So if we use the conventional press cycle, it is common to have the spring back effect, but it is possible to use different cycles to reduce the speed, the drawing speed, to make some oscillation cycles during the drawing, or to make a restroke in the bottom of the center, improve the spring back of the part. Regarding the equation, and specifically in this kind of installations, also the advantage is, in this case, we've got a full capacity in the reverse motion. Yeah? In the hydraulic equation is not like that, but in the equation, we got the possibility to go touching the slide up to the bottom of the center of the equation. So this is good to obtain bigger production in this kind of installations, but also we've got the possibility to make force, the total force during the reverse movement, and this is not possible with hydraulic cushions, and it's interesting also for high stress steels. Okay, again, some references: Benteler, Volkswagen, Daimler, OEMs and tier ones, FIE, Gestamp, and Volkswagen again. Good. Hot stamping. Okay, in our case, we've got a cooperation agreement with the company BAT in the Basque Country, and that it is called Hotenic, and we are offering to the market a turnkey solution in these processes. We make the installation, and BAT is making the tools, so we can offer a turnkey solution for hot stamping, steel for hot stamping. I will speak a little bit first about the steel hot stamping and then aluminum hot stamping. So this is a typical hot stamping line with a destacking system, could be robots or could be automation, a specific automation system. The furnace to heat the steel. Then there is the loading station to the press, the unloading station, and in the end could be also to have the stacking, automatic stacking system. Or could be manual also. So we are integrating all of them. Regarding the press, we will see now different options. Could be a conventional hydraulic press. It is the most common solution in the market. So more or less 12,000 or 15,000 kilonewton, the booster area 2.2 by 3 meters, more or less. It is needed a high speed, down and up, to obtain a good parts and to have a high production. The servo controlled, die refrigeration integrated, hidden die clamps, compact upright design, and so on. This is the conventional press, but could be also a servo mechanical press. Yeah. We made a development 3 years ago, and it is more expensive, but it has several advantages. It has a reduced press cycle due to the press speed, due to the position accuracy, so we can reduce the safety gap with the automation, and the advanced automation system also. It is much more effective, efficient, energy efficient, so we can reduce more or less the half energy that we are using compared with a hydraulic press. Less maintenance, because a mechanical system are more reliable from the maintenance point of view than hydraulics. And we can improve the part quality, and the process is more stable. Okay, we can see, again, a video of a steel hot stamping in this installation with a mechanical servo press. This is the loading the steel to the furnace. It's coming out, and the automation is going with the part to the die. Good. I would like to speak also about a new process that is working in Gestamp, our customer, that is patented, but they were working hot stamping with a multi-step process. So in a transfer press, not a single press, they are working in a transfer press. So we supplied this installation to Gestamp, and they have a couple of patents to protect the installation or the development of this process. Yeah. They are saying that they can produce more than 15 SPM parts per minute with this process. Good, again some references of steel hot stamping, Tower, Batz, Tower, Gestamp, Seat, Volkswagen in Germany, in Kassel. Good, and now hot stamping, but aluminum hot stamping. We've got a project with Mondragon University to develop this process. We are focused mainly in two processes, W-temper and hot forming. Both processes, we can say that are quite similar, but in one of them, we are heating the aluminum up to the solution heat treatment temperature. We are quenching the aluminum and then forming. Once the aluminum is cooled down, we form the part. And then we need the artificial aging to obtain the good hardness of the material. And then in the hot forming process, the cooling down of the material and the forming is made both together. This is the main difference. So comparing with both processes, we can say that for the automation system or press cycle complexity are similar. The tool complexity is also not so easy in both of them. From the point of view of the galling, it's worse the hot stamping because the aluminum is in a higher temperature and it's a problem for the die. Geometry accuracy, it's better specifications with hot stamping because it's more malleable, the material. Drawability is better the W-temper. But it happens the opposite with the formability, with the same effect of geometric accuracy. And in both cases, we need a post-aging of the material. So as I said, we are investing in the characterization of all these parameters, we would like to know what is the influence of the temperature, influence of the time in the oven, what is the minimum or the maximum time we thought to move the part from the oven or from the furnace to the press and so on, in order to define the optimum installation to offer to the market this process. Good, next item, the composite cells. In this area, I would like to do two processes, long fibers and continuous fibers. In long fibers, usually the customers are working with three processes. The first one is this, the SMC, sheet mold compound. The matrix is a thermoset resin, and we are using the material is a cut glass fiber, but in the last times it is also using the carbon fiber, and the raw material is in coils. These are more or less the specifications of the installation. Yeah, it is the press. It must have a high precision active parallelism control system. It is a hydraulic press. Both are dimensional, more or less 3.6 by 2.4 meters. Tonnage is between 800 and 4,000 tons. And regarding automation, it is needed a decoiling system, a slitter, to cut the material that is coming from the coil, and then robots and the special grippers to deal with the material. The second process that is using also in the market is GMT, glass mat thermoplastic. In this case, the matrix is a thermoplastic. The reinforcement is a glass fiber. And the raw material is coming in cut formats, so it's a format that it's going to the furnace to heat and to lift the material correctly, and then with the robots it's coming to the mold and then to a cooling tunnel, or could be with no cooling tunnel. Okay, the press is very similar, the same specifications regarding the tooling, but in the automation again we need a robot, furnace in this case, and the special grippers to deal with the material. And the third process that is used in the market is DLFT, direct long fiber thermoplastics. Again, this is a thermoplastic, but in this case, the raw material is built during the process. Glass fiber again. Fiber is in rubbings, and the thermoplastic is in pellets, and the extruder is mixing the material, and the robot is moving the material from the extruder to the press. Again, the press is very similar as the previous processes, and in automation, yeah, it's needed the extruding system to mix the material and the special grippers. Yeah. Okay, the second process, the continuous fibers, could be glass fiber or carbon fiber with thermoset or thermoplastic. In this case, it is necessary to build first, before going to the mold, to build the preform. Yeah, the preform, it's important to place the carbon fiber, for example, in the right position with the right orientation of the fibers. So first, and it needs a small consolidation, and this is the preform. And then this goes to the mold. So depends how is the mold procedure, but it has several names, let's say. But it's RTM, high pressure RTM. So the preform goes into the mold closes down. There is the injection phase in high pressure. And then once the part is cured, it's opening and the part goes out. This is the high pressure RTM. Compression RTM, it's similar, but in this case, the mold is not closed completely. There is a small gap, and the injection system goes from the gap to the older part. Then comes the compression phase, and once the part is cured, it opens and there is the part finished. Wet compression is similar, but instead of having the resin injection in the mold, it's before the mold. It's the resin deposit on the part. All the rest is the same. And in the thermoplastic multi-material, in this case, the raw material, let's say, is the organic sheet. It's a carbon fiber with a thermoplastic resin. So in this case, it is needed to heat the material and then to produce the part. And even it is possible to inject thermoplastic to make the part more complex, let's say. From the point of view of the press, could be two architectures, could be the a conventional press, or could be a shorter stroke press. They have similar specific characteristics, but this design is more compact and more energy efficient. Both of them need a high precision active servo control parallelism control, and the energy consumption is optimized for each cycle. So we will see now a video of the CRTM process. So put the preform inside, injection, gap impregnation, compression, and the part. This is a Maserati bonnet. So first of all, we made some calculation, simulation, to calculate the press cycle. We can see here the layout of the installation. And this is the real mold with the real machine. So the mold booster is coming in with the mold. The slide is taking the mold. The booster goes out. This is a preform, in this case it's located manually, but could be also with robots in a real production site. The slide is closed with a gap of 1.8 millimeters. The injection phase. You can see there the part, how it comes out. And this is the part once it's out of the mold and cured. And we can see here the final part that we was in the exhibition of JEC in Paris this year. This is a new process. Nowadays they are making this part in a prepreg process. So it's much longer and much expensive, and the new possibility to make it faster and more cheaper. So some references, again, in composites, Fier Patch, a good customer, BMW, Seoul Composites, FBAT, FPK, and Fritz Meyer, Germany. So that was all. Yeah. If you have any question.
Okay, thank you, Andoitz, for this very didactical speech, okay, showing us the inner side of the machines. Any question for Andoitz? The composite people, maybe, or? No question? Okay, so I will do one, okay, well, one or two. I have a curiosity. Which percentage of the current installations in sheet metal forming is servo versus conventional?
Servo, we started making servo presses in 2006, I think. The first one was in the Mondragon University. In the beginning years, it was not a big offer or big, they were not asking a lot. They are asking more and more because they have several advantages. But nowadays, I would say that yet the conventional presses are more ask more than a servo presses. So I would say 30-40% are servo and 50 with conventional. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Any other question from the audience? Okay, I have another one. Okay, this is more technical. We discussed some weeks ago. Okay, the mechanical servo cushion. You could use the cushion doing more force just before the bottom dead center so that you can stretch the material in the ready and reduce spring back. This is possible with the mechanical cushions as well as in the hydraulic, or You mentioned the maximum force in the upper movement. I haven't understood this.
Yeah, in a conventional hydraulic cushion, it has the capability to make the nominal force during the down movement when it's the drawing phase. But in the reverse movement, it has not much capacity. Yeah. It is not happening this with the electromechanic cushion. The cushion, in the end, it's a servo mechanic drive, and it has the capability to make the force where you want to do. Yeah. So it could be when the drawing process, it could be in the reverse process, it could be in the near the bottom of the center. If we want to make a peak of force, it is possible. Or even if we want to make a restroke, and in the restroke we want to maintain the force, it is also possible.
Okay, thank you. Any additional comment from the audience? If not, I want to ask you a big applause for Andoitz, and thank you for coming. Yes.
So now it's time for parallel sessions. Thank you very much.